Hello, my name is Esteban Serna. I am a senior DynamoDB specialist solution architect, and in my role, I help customers to optimize their access patterns and their data models to get really low response times and increase throughput. In today's video, we're going to discuss a situation that I have faced with many different customers. It is called hot partitions, rolling hotkeys, sliding keys, monotonic hotkey. It has very different names, but the symptoms are very similar. What is a hot partition? It is when you're trying to write into the same virtual partition inside an Amazon DynamoDB table. As you might know, virtual partitions store one or more combinations of partition key and SOAR keys inside a DynamoDB table. As an example, if you create one DynamoDB table, your data could be stored in one virtual partition. That means all the combination of your partition keys and SOAR key could be stored in there. DynamoDB behind the scenes will give you more virtual partitions as your traffic requires, or if you choose to provision those. Now, let's talk about the scenario. I have created one table, which is called the quotes table. This quotes table has an hypothetical application of users that create quotes over the internet. Each one of these users might belong to an organization, and each one of the posts or the quotes has a quote identifier. This is my quotes DynamoDB table. As you can see, it has nearly 88 million quotes from different users, and it's about 40 gigabytes. The average item size is 447 bytes, and I have created one global secondary index that is called the migration index, which I'm going to introduce the situation that we're going to face. Now, before we go into the index, let's explore the table data. So I'm just going to run a scan operation. I'm just going to get some of the quotes from the different users, and let's explore this data. For example, if I grab the first one, you're seeing that the identifier is that the partition key is the user ID, which is a nano ID in this scenario. The SOAR key, it is the date when that quote was created, and it has a quote ID to ensure that in case we have a very active users that produces several quotes per second, we ensure that this partition key, this primary key is unique. You can see that I also created one GSI called with the organization where the partition key is organization and the SOAR key is the user ID that created that quote, the date of the quote, and the quote ID for the same reasons that before. You can say I could get all the quotes from the users that belong to the Bravo organization by using this global secondary index. All the other information is just metadata that I'm not really going to use in this example. What I would like to show you is what information I can get from the index. With my global secondary index, let me just grab information from Bravo organization. So let's select the migration index. Let's do a query operation where the partition key is organization Bravo. So I'm going to get where the SOAR key begins with user, and then I put the user ID. If I run this query, I'm going to get some information about that specific user. You will see that this user ID, all the information, it is about the same user ID, which I have right here. Now, what's the situation that I might be facing? What I want to do is to migrate all the messages from the users, from the Bravo organization. Yeah, pretty simple. Since I have the GSI, I can just do a query operation, grab the users as you're seeing right now, from the Bravo organization, and then write them into the new DynamoDB table, right? So it's really straightforward. This table has a lot of records from memory. I think this user specifically has about 4.5 million quotes. So it has a lot of data that is pretty well distributed. You are seeing that the partition key and the SOAR key of the index, it is a very high cardinal number. So you might think, I should not have any issue with this, with running this migration. Let me show what happens if you approach the migration in this way. If you go to CloudWatch, this is an example that I ran a couple of days ago, where the logic in my script was, let's grab all the information from the global secondary index that I just mentioned, from the Bravo organization, and from this specific user. I reduced the scope for velocity purposes. And when I try to write back, I created an EC2 instance running on a script using 16 cores, just writing in parallel batch write item operations into the new DynamoDB table, which is this one. And look what happened. I was limited all the time at 1,000 writes per second. During all the migration period, all the moment that the script was executing, I couldn't get more than 1,000 writes per second. Here is my application code. It is very straightforward. You can see that I obtained the maximum number of CPU from this specific server, depending on the EC2 instance, and I initialized them in the Boto3 client. Very important to do this, because if not, it will be limited to 10 clients. I have the source table, the code table, the destination table. I have my organization and my user ID. From this expression, I read information from the organization. I paginate across all the different results, and I put the elements in a queue. I have a consumer method that will put 25 items at a time into the queue, so I can do a batch write item. And then I finally do a processing operation. This processing operation is going to start the number of threads that I have created, send the consumer, send the data in the queue to the consumer, and then wait until they finish and return the time that it consumed. Finally, the write organization, I'm doing a batch write item over here, and I'm getting all the requests that I received from the queue. I send them, and in case there are unprocessed items, I send them back to the queue so I can retry them later. You can see I first initialize the queue. I do create one thread for the reads, and I wait until all the reads. I know that is not the most efficient approach, but that's the way that I chose to do. I get all of these 4.5 million items. And once I do that, look at this. I first sort the items and make sure that they're sorted in ascending order. I don't have to do that, but I did in this scenario because DynamoDB already gave me that way. And then I invert them just to prove my point. I create three queues, working queue, inverted queue, and random queue. I put all the items in the working queue, and then I put all the items in the inverted queue from the inverted items. And at the end, I add some nulls to avoid the to signal the thread to stop working. I run that operation. I first do the read. Then descending order, then I do it in ascending order, the inverted queue. And finally, when I do these two, I shuffle. Look at this, it's very simple, it's no secret sauce. I do a random shuffle for the items, and I put in the random queue. And finally, I write the information in the shuffle queue. They will give me the, and then I print the results. These were some of the results that I did, that I run the other day. Actually, this has 6.5 million items, this query that I did. And these were the number of seconds that it took for each one of those. Now, going back to CloudWatch. First, it was descending. The second time was ascending. In the scenario number 3 that I'm going to show you right now, look how high I was able to get the writes from this table. It moved from 1,000 writes per second during all the duration of the test to almost 5,700 write capacity units for a short duration of the period. This shuffle operation allowed me to distribute this data across the entire spectrum. It was no longer in order, and I was able to achieve higher throughput. You might be thinking, I don't believe you. It seems like there is something else behind the scenes. So that's what I generated, something that internally we call a heat map. Heat maps will provide views behind the scenes how the virtual partitions in DynamoDB are behaving. So this is the heat map. It starts at 7 p.m. and it ends at 8 p.m. I can only get these files one per hour. And it contains a test that I ran before, the one that I show you, but it tells you for this specific partition, you can see that the writes per second, the IOPS, was almost in 1,000 all the time. And when it tried to write into this virtual partition, then it moved to the next one. It tried to write all the elements from that virtual partition and it continued to move. Hence the rolling hotkey. Here is your moving your hot partition is moving from partition to partition. When I inverted the order, what I got the result was similar, only that the partitions were hit in a different order. Heat maps are very useful to see how well distributed is your traffic. So this one was from 7 to 8. Let me just open the one at 8. And now, look at this. This is also the second portion of the load test. You can see that it still had the rolling hot partition. It was not as pretty as before that you can see actually the diagonal on the heat map, but the symptoms are the same. But here, what happened when I shuffled the records before sending the information back to the new DynamoDB table, I distributed my data. DynamoDB likes to write data across the entire spectrum. Don't focus just one virtual partition. And by just randomizing the item that you had from your query, I was able to take advantage of this one, two, three, four, for the five different virtual partitions that I had. So I consume higher throughput in total because each one of these was consuming 400, but I was consuming 400 for each virtual partition. This is what we like to see in heat maps. We like to see that your traffic is very well distributed and it is not just focused in one single virtual partition at any time. So try to avoid this kind of spikes in traffic, especially in this migration, because you're in control. If this kind of situation is because of organic traffic, that's a different thing to, there are different ways to handle that. But when you're in control of the writes, as you should be, this kind of graphs is what we would like to see. All the information distributed across the entire partitions, across the entire duration of the writes. You can see that it started at 8:25:20 and it ended at 8:43. And if you go back to CloudWatch, you can see 8:24 to 8:44, 43 pretty much. So here you have it. Here is how you can see the situation of the rolling hotkey. Below you can see the throttles that we had. They are not in synchronized. You can see that when it starts at 7:20 p.m., 7:25, it's like with this load test, and then it keeps throttling until 7:50 p.m., which is over here. Remember, these times are in GTM, and it starts again with the inverted test. But finally, at 8:24, there are no more throttles. So we were able to fully use the power of DynamoDB. So the invitation that I have for you over here, it is to always distribute your traffic across the different virtual partitions. DynamoDB will allow you to write a lot of traffic, a lot of throughput, as long as you write an application, distribute your traffic across the entire spectrum, meaning across all the virtual partitions. I hope that this video is useful and it might help you in future migrations by just simply shuffling your elements. You can avoid this kind of situation, the hotkey situation or the rolling hotkey. Other possibility that you might have, you can query from your index, but do it by users. In our scenario, we had the quotes by date. So what if I start getting information from different users day by day? That's a different possibility, and it's also valid. The choice is yours. the idea is not to read all the data from the original DynamoDB table and then write it blindly into the new DynamoDB table, because that will cause the rolling hotkey situation. Shuffle that data and you will have higher throughput. Thank you for listening. My name is Esteban Serna. I am a senior DynamoDB specialist, and see you in the next video. Thank you.